Good evening, everybody, and thank you for being here tonight with Maestro Guidarini and me. So, we're going to talk, of course, about Traviata and Verdi a little bit tonight. Maestro, the title of the opera sounds very fancy and glamorous because it belongs to the tradition of renowned Italian operas, right? But as you all may know, Traviata is a more polite way to address a prostitute, although a very refined one, well-educated, and with extremely great taste. It would be like having nowadays a theater bill or a commercial sign with the sign of the prostitute by Giuseppe Verdi. At that time, it was quite a scandal. Wasn't it? And what was the reception of the audience?
Well, of course, nowadays, if one would say that a woman is a traviata, one would think immediately about Verdi, one would say, but in fact, I mean, the origins of this come from a literary which is, of course, La Dame aux Camélias by Alexandre Dumas. Alexandre Dumas wrote this very famous novel that then ultimately became a play for theater. And then from that play, Verdi, through the work of this very famous libretto writer, Francesco Maria Piante, they sort of ended up working together on this that ultimately has become a wonderful masterpiece that we all know. I would say that the element that is more shocking, that has been more shocking in that time, was the fact that because of this literary source, the audience was experimenting the fact of going into a theater and listening to an opera that was actually contemporary. That is the main scandal, I would say, in the sense that it was the first time that this happened, so that an audience, that an operatic audience, was going in a theater seeing an opera that was dealing with contemporary matters. It's like as if it may sound like a sort of basic example, but it is as if we were going to see an opera dealing with I don't know, Clinton or Obama or Berlusconi or something like that. I mean, just of course, it's not exactly the same because I mean the historical and cultural context is very, is, of course, is no compare. But I do think that the element that is has been shocking in this respect is was it has been not simply the fact that we are dealing with Traviata. With a woman that she lives, although she lives in an extraordinary kind of a social situation, because she's a mondaine more than a maîtresse, more than a, let's say, in bracket, prostitute. It's very often, as you know, these ladies in this time were sometimes artists, very often writers themselves, or painters, or that actually have been a source of inspiration for artists, not only maîtresses of prime ministers or very important people. It's a notion that is, of course, not in this sense comparable to what we have nowadays in terms of what the prostitute is. So, but I believe that the main thing is about the fact that this kind of situation, if they are dealt with a different historical setting, that is, if they, let's say, they concern the past, they don't, again in brackets, they don't offend the morality. In fact, what happened in the case of Traviata, which probably is interesting to point out, is the fact that at the beginning the reception was but let's say difficult, because I mean, of course, everyone understood that it was a phenomenal masterpiece of music. But this fact was rather somehow hurting. So it happened that the censorship, had tried to put the context of Traviata back in the 18th century, not in the 19th century, that is Verdian time. Just to tell you how in this time it might have been a scandal in this sense. I think that this aspect has been more shocking than what we were mentioning before.
Thanks. So, would you like to talk a little bit about Traviata? Not only about Violetta Valeri, who is the main protagonist, the main character, of course, and we all know, as yep. you were saying, that she is, of course, inspired by Marie du Plessis, this maîtresse d'élégance, and the peers of the second half of the
90s, and they died later, yes.
And she died, and she loved camellias because they had no scent, and she was the only flower with a scent. That's why she used to wear camellias. What does this character, what does Violetta, what does Traviata represent to the composer, to Verdi? We were talking about some similarities with the composer, his life, or inspiration.
Well, I can say what I feel about that, because of course you all know about Traviata, you know, opera lovers, they know about the story, they know a lot of things about this character. With years, I mean, having the privilege of conducting most of Verdian operas, I have the perception, the more I sort of grow with it, the more I actually have this journey, my personal journey of my life, through the fact of conducting all these masterpieces by Verdi, is the fact that ultimately, in different ways, they all deal with human and ethical matters, almost. If there is a characteristic about Verdi, to me at least, is that whatever is the title that one considers, there are sort of patterns, not only musical, but they actually are patterns that they deal with what we are, what human beings are. So, and therefore, there is this phenomenal gallery of human beings that one meets. It's like, I'd like just to underline, for instance, that in the same time that Verdi writes Traviata, almost in the same period, he writes as well Trovatore and Rigoletto, which is called then normally like the so-called popular trilogy, you know, trilogia popolare, and it's about what these, for instance, these simply three operas, for not mentioning the other others, they deal with sort of human categories. And if you take a giant like Rigoletto, is by no means less extraordinary than Traviata, but it's almost like the other side of the coin. Sort of, so in the case of Traviata specifically, if I may say, is there is the fact that somehow has a kind of a resonance with Verdi's own life. I don't think one should forget the fact that when Verdi wrote Traviata, being like 40 years old, grosso modo, I mean, 39, 40 years old, he had already experienced in his own life the loss of his first wife and the two children in the maybe 1 year and a half time, 2 years time. And then, after the grief of that as a young man, then he finally he met, of course, Giuseppina Strepponi, who was being his companion and his wife for the rest of his life. They have been together for 50 years, you know, after that. But in this stage of his personal life, he was actually living with Giuseppina Strepponi, who had been a very famous singer, singing the protagonist in Nabucco, for instance, which was a really wonderful artist. And they had they were living sort of a marital status, like sort of sharing the life and living together, but they were not married. Which, of course, then again, in contemporary times, this is something that, of course, we don't actually even consider a matter of discussion. But in that context, in the context of 19th century society, Catholic society, being Verdi already a legend a legend, because he was one of the most, if not the most known person of Italy around the world. He was like almost already as considered as Michelangelo, in the sense he had already status out of maybe like Rossini in this sense, no? Really well known and really considered like almost a symbol of what the Italian culture, not only music, the Italian culture was in the world. The fact of having his own private life so off, so that is not exactly in the frame of what a bourgeois kind of life in a Catholic country, in a deeply Catholic country was. I think that resonates a lot. In fact, it's very interesting because he takes a position, there is even a letter that he wrote publicly about the fact that, because Giuseppina Streponi and Verdi actually decided to live in the small village of near Busseto in Sant'Agata. Busseto is as little as two blocks of Toronto. I mean, it's literally a small village, a fantastic small village. Mm-hmm. And in that context as well, the fact of coming back with the woman that was, of course, somehow out of that context, because he had been married with someone that was sort of a local, the daughter of the very famous Seville, yes. So I do think that somehow the fact of acknowledging the somehow the independence of his wife as a person that decided to live with a man without being, I do think that somehow resonates in that. So in this sense, what Verdi does in Traviata is the fact of publicly sort of making a statement in this effect, let's say that sometimes the most moral person in a frame of society is the one that looks the less moral. And it's a case of Traviata.
Talking a little bit more in depth about the opera and the musical aspects of this masterpiece. In the very first act, we have two of the most allegedly famous arias of Italian opera. The toast, Libiamo nelle calici, and then the Sempre Libera by Violetta. I would like you to spend some words about this contrast between the first toast that is such a glittery, sparkling as a glass of champagne moment, and then the Sempre Libera, that is the real dramatic moment for Violetta when she realizes that she has to remind herself to love many men and to have many lovers in order to be free.
Well, these two very, very famous moments that we all know, because the Brindisi has now played in all sorts of occasions and situations, and like a sort of a very, festival and very colorful piece of, they even call it sort of a drinking song. So it's one of those, dramatically, from a dramatical point of view, that is in the context of what Verdi writes, that in fact, this so-called drinking song, questo brindisi, is the very first moment when there is a contact between Alfredo and Violetta. In fact, what happens just in the scene before, just before the brindisi, there is a moment where they say, well, you should make a toast, etc. And then Gaston, this small person, one of these people that belong to this society, says, well, you should be the one, and say, no, I'm shy, etc. No, please, go ahead. Then it says, ultimately, then he addresses to us, unless you really feel like I should do it, then I do. He said, yes, please go ahead. And then he starts that. So the drinking song, in fact, the brindisi, it's about, there is a sparkle which is very exciting, of course, from the point of view of the music, but it's in fact it's very important because it's the moment when, out of some kind of a social happening, the two sort of interact. And in the moment where actually starts this toast, in fact these two young persons, they look in the eyes, and there is, of course, this phenomenal attraction between the two of them. So in fact, she answers the toast, but the text that she has already deals with something that is not exactly about the drinking, but somehow deals with how she feels about it. And then, so there is already a contact that is established between the two of them. Then there is, once the bridge is off, then they have this moment where they are on their own. And then from the very first minute, they start to talk about things that probably people would say after months of knowledge of one another. And that is really extraordinary. So he opens up like, and he tells her in 2 minutes, I've been in love with you since 1 year. And then of course she's like, and so she tries to sort of get him away from this. And say, first she sort of teases him and says, oh, come on, I guess, well, they all say that. But then, so she tries, but even trying, one feels that there is something about her that has been somehow touched. And then in fact, when she remains on her own, when they are all away, then she sees this phenomenal thing that is A Forse Lui, mm-hmm. before the famous Sempre Libera. And in A Forse Lui, she says, she sings to herself, saying, can he be the one that I've been thinking of since I was a little girl? So for a moment, this very famous mondaine, this person that has been, you know, God knows what kind of a private personal life had until that moment, she, when she speaks with herself, she says, and in fact she doesn't know him, it's just met him in 2 minutes, it's one of those coup de foudre in a sense, but goes very profoundly, so touches very profoundly the Violetta in her heart. And so she sees this phenomenal arioso, and then as if she was trying to sort of wake up from this dream, she sings Sempre Libera, saying, oh, come on, how can you possibly even think about something like that? And in fact, when she, just before she gave that to him, she addresses to him saying, you know, if you really are in love with me, please go away, because just forget it. I'm the least person you should try to be in touch with. And then she sees Sempre Libera. The reason of the Sempre Libera, I think, has a meaning only if one considers this, that it's in, like in 5 minutes, she's kind of seeing her life with different eyes. So she sings Sempre Libera, saying, no, I have to be free, I have to enjoy myself, I need to change a man every night, because that's my life. That's my life. That's what it is.
Then there is not only Traviata, it's not only about Violetta, it's not only about Alfredo, there is another sort of pivotal character. Of course, we all know the beautiful Di Provenza and Mother Swan, right? And I'm referring to Germont's father, right?
Yes.
Yeah, and it's the father of Alfredo. Would you like to talk a little bit more about this, the relationship between the father and the son that is absolutely crucial in the opera, and also, surprisingly, the relationship between the father and to-be daughter, Violetta, in the final act. She is named daughter by Germont, right? So, shall we talk a little bit about this relationship?
Yes, getting back to what was said before, that is that what I do feel about the Verdian process towards his characters is, and about certain topics that one finds rather regularly in his works, the relationship with the, let's say, so-called father figure is there almost in almost every main opera, with different characteristics. But then again, if you go back briefly to Rigoletto that we mentioned before, the essential, quintessential thing about Rigoletto is the relationship as a father toward Gilda, which is a very twisted one, a very complicated one, because basically we have a man that is tormented, that keeps his own daughter almost like in a prison, And that ultimately that's the cause why Gilda ends up doing what she does. I mean, falling in love with the first person that first young man that she meets in a church that happens to be the Duke. And that, so that element of the relationship with the father figure is already there very deeply. Now, in Traviata, the relationship between Alfredo and his father, then again, it's a very problematic one. If one considers that, well, who brought Alfredo in that place? I mean, in Florence, who brought Alfredo there? His father. That is, one has to consider that, of course, we cannot call these places brothels, of course, by all means. And these were beautiful places where, you know, salon of people who were actually having a social life. And yet, because of the presence of this mondaine, was as well a way of somehow, particularly for the young men of the bourgeoisie, to getting maybe to have their first sexual experiences in a sort of a way. That is, I must say, coming from Italy, you know, this thing actually has lasted since probably a generation of my parents. That is, I mean, it was rather common to the fact of going in places where, you know, a young man could meet women that were sort of somehow giving the first sexual experiences to young men. So, of course, in the case of Verdi, it's very subtle, so we don't know, it's not said, it doesn't say that, of course, it's been Germain Baer bringing the young man there. Yet, because of that sort of social frame, the fact that the young man belonging to a certain kind of society had to go, there was absolutely normal, it's like today to go to a party of a certain kind. So, but this is only the surface, of course, and the important was not to talk about it. That is, all that sort of society knew that in these situations that certain things might have happened. And yet, that should have been sort of somehow not openly spoken about. That's what happens when in the famous scene when he throws the money to says, questa donna pagata io ho. That's the main scandal, because that's the last thing you should do. That is, although they all know somehow that at some point the lady is somehow paid in a certain way. Most of them have maybe an apartment or they were, you know, yes, jewels or sort of things. But this act, the violence of the act, is the fact of having humiliated the person in front of everyone. Now, so, getting back to the relationship with the father, I mean, so even that, the fact that Alfredo finds himself in a place like that, probably comes because of this, you know, kind of typology of relationship with father-son, which they sound like very, very, very weird. If a father would bring his own son into a place for, although that still happened, though. Not in such a conventional social way, not in the exactly the same, but so that relationship is by Verdi not only put on stage, but Verdi reveals somehow the false identity of this relationship that is meant to be based on moral values, and yet. You know, in one side you have the family, that is the Catholic family with wife, children, etc. And then you have the other side that deals with, you know, sexuality and all that. Maybe it's someone that has the courage of not only putting this very delicate subject on stage, but of making it a masterpiece out of it. The element that actually causes the change of the life of Violetta is when she meets Germain Baer. Because, as you know, at some point when Violetta and Alfredo live together in the second act, we find them that they seem to live a normal life, because she has left, not only she has left her previous life, but she has given away all her money that she has earned through her previous lives. She gives away the money to poor people. So, and they ultimately find themselves running out of money because she has done that. But in that moment, when they seem to live a beautifully happy life, here comes the father of Alfredo saying, I know that you're happy, but I have a daughter. This daughter had a fiancé, so she was meant to marry someone, but since this person has known that Alfredo was living in sin with you, he doesn't want to marry her anymore. So he tells her to sacrifice her own life on because of this. She even says something to me, it sounds terrifying. Siate l'angelo consolatore, which is, please become the angel savior of my own family. Which is, so I almost give you the opportunity of, you know, coming from where you were to become some sort of a saint, some sort of, you know. And there she collapses. There she collapses because she realizes that ultimately her life with Alfredo is impossible because she has this curse of having been what she was, which means for the society remaining a Traviata. So to me, I mean, the Traviata, as well as the score, even as well as the way it's conceived, there is sort of a climax, and that's when she meets with Germain Bell, with the father, and from there onwards, it's like a tragedy. Then sort of she collapses. She goes, not casually she falls sick, and not casually she dies. So out of this, so that's my perception.
I found very fascinating when we were talking for the interview, the idea you have, and you were mentioning both the moment, the idea that she's like a biblical figure, right? She's like Mary of Magdalene, right?
Yes,
she's a prostitute first, and then she becomes sort of saint. And I found extremely interesting your interpretation of she being the only moral character of the opera. Can we talk a little bit?
Well, of course, this has to be put in a context. I mean, in the context of what the frame of morality was at that time, which, of course, let's be frank, is not the same that we have nowadays. I mean, nowadays to deal with these sexual matters has become, let's say, sort of not only a daily matter, but nobody's astonished about anything nowadays in this sense. Whether in that frame of society, in that, let's say, culture, I mean, the fact of having a certain way of presenting oneself towards the society was necessary. If you wanted to have a career, if you wanted to be someone, I mean, you had to sort of follow a certain kind of frame. If you didn't, then you were somehow out of that. So, but this is not, of course, the problem is that this kind of surface seem to correspond to moral values. This is what that kind of bourgeois society say. That is, you know, to be a moral person, you have to be married, you have to be, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You have to, of course, to believe in God, to have, you know, patria, Dio, famiglia, the 19th century values. I mean, if you somehow were outside those values, well, you don't belong, you even don't belong to the society. This is what Verdi say, you know. How is possible that, and then to underline the sort of double language about what real values are, he deliberately make this phenomenal portrait of this woman. When I say it's a biblical character, I mean to say is if you see, if you read what happens with Maria di Magdala, Maria Maddalena, when in the famous moment when Jesus Christ, so when he's pointed out by the you know, by the sacerdote, saying, "But you know, Jesus, Maestro, this person is a prostitute." Then he says this famous thing, saying, "You know, well, this person has been washing my feet with her own tears, and it's been, you know, asciugato with her hair, my. So, and therefore, then what implicit says, but vater is made non peccare più, and then she's sort of somehow liberated by the words of Jesus Christ. What happens in Traviata somehow is a biblical story in the sense that the person that is, let's say, the one that lives his sin, because that's her life, although the surface is always elegant, but I mean, she lives in sin, and she lives so much in sin that is condemned by a father figure like Germain Pepper. But then ultimately what happens is she sacrifices, she gives her life. She gives her life for the fact that this other girl that she doesn't know, dite alla giovine si belle pura, when she sings that, you can say to the young lady that there is a victim though, but you know, I sort of e che sacrifica e che morrà. Plus, she knows already that she is somehow condemned by her own sickness, because that the sickness is another element that is in there too. So she's not even allowed to have a few years of happiness, although she knows that she's gonna die. She knows that, and nevertheless, she allows that happening. And so, therefore, I mean, what happens in the end to me is like this sense of moral somehow. Transformation of the character, like as if she becomes a very elevated spirit. But that happens even in Gilda, and some of that. I mean, if you remember, that sort of, she's killed basically by her own father. I mean, although of course it's Parafucile doing that. But then when she ultimately dies in the arms of her father, she said, "Lassù in cielo vicino la madre." No, what happens to Traviata is that. The last words she says to Alfredo are incredible, because she says something like, "Se una pudica vergine," she actually tells him, "If you find a pudica vergine," that is a virgin in your life, that is the one that I'm not, that I could never be for you. If you find someone like that, che è una pudica vergine, sposati sia o vo, she says, "Please marry her because I want it." And that, after that, she dies. So, I mean, the journey that this character has accomplished by, in this sense, I mean, from the figure of being somehow, an escort. To this is huge. That's my thing when I say that she's the only ethical character in this sense. Because if you compare how comes out the father figure out of that, because if he has destroyed her life, then ultimately in the last act he says, "Amal cauto vegliardo, il marchio feci, I realize how I've been terrible to you, but it's too late now." But the way he comes out in this sense, being the character that represents the values compared to her, that is the one that is actually a sinner. Well, it's extraordinary in this sense.
Thank you. Before opening up the floor to some questions or doubts or curiosity, if you have some about the production that is going to open up this Thursday at the Canadian Opera Company, I would like to dedicate one last question to something we were talking about a couple of days ago, and this is idea that you gave me that I think is just beautiful. When you think about the prelude, the ouverture of Traviata, and you said, let me quote you, that is a tenerissimo flashback, a most touching flashback. Because, as you know, the overture is also repeated at the beginning of Act third of the third act. So it also speaks to the genius of Verdi. You know, I think that we're able to picture a flashback in a movie, in the cinema, but to imagine a flashback in musical terms, I mean, this utterly speaks to the genius of Verdi. So what does it mean to have the most touching flashback as an overture?
As you know, until, let's say, the middle 19th century, each opera was beginning with an overture, both opera comica or opera seria, I mean, whatever was it, was buffo or was serious, but there was mainly, almost always, I would say, an overture. An overture, sometime, of course, means simply an opening of the story. In some cases, overture were actually containing elements, that is, themes, musical themes, that one might or not meet during the opera. Well, sometimes the themes were dealing with the characters of the opera, sometimes not. In the very famous case, Don Giovanni, for instance. If you take the Mozart Italiano, I mean, in some cases you have the themes, like the opera of Don Giovanni, you don't find the themes of the opera at all in the rest of the opera, or Nozze di Figaro. I mean, you don't find that theme. It's just La Folle Journée. Now, in the Italian operas, you always have the overtures. In some cases, the overtures, they are so beautiful that they become concert pieces. And in the case of Verdi, of course, I mean, I conducted, I don't know how many times Forza del Destino, for instance, or Vesperi Siciliani, which are fantastic pieces of music. They almost become like a movement of a symphony. I mean, sort of a concert piece, fantastic concert piece that deals in different ways with the opera that they belong to. Now, at starting from a certain point onwards of his artistic journey, Verdi feels that the overture as such is a sort of a piece of the past, I mean, belonging to a certain way of writing operas. What he tries to do, the more he goes on with his artistic journey, is to try to find a way so that the overture somehow belongs completely to what the opera will deal with. So therefore you have overtures that become very often preludes. A prelude is not exactly an opera because, first of all, doesn't have the same form, that is not structured as a sort of a movement of a symphony, structured like a slow part at the beginning and the fast one following. The prelude is more of something that has to suggest somehow a feeling or an atmosphere of the opera. Now that I'm thinking, for instance, Simone Boccanegra. Simone doesn't have neither a prelude nor even an overture. There are simply like 10 seconds of music that sort of evocate the sea, the waves of the sea, because Simone is a famous hero of the sea, is a famous sailor, un famoso pirata. So there's only this sort of phenomenal way of evocating the sea. Now, in Traviata, the prelude has this function, of course, because it actually does deal with the rest of the opera, but in a very specific way, because, and this can be understood only knowing, having done the entire journey of the opera. Why? Because the theme of the prelude, being the very famous theme, is exactly the same that we find at the beginning of the third act, where she is dying. She's now, you know, the illusion of living with Alfredo is gone. She's completely in deep down in her sickness, and she knows she's gonna die. And in fact, the core of that act is completely different from everything else, completely different from the sort of festa of the first act, and with the sort of dramatic situation of the second act, with what we mentioned before about the father and with what happens with Alfredo. So the third act, there is this nudity of her being in her loneliness, with sickness, dealing with the sickness, and dealing with the fact that she might not see Alfredo before dying. And then, you know, the fact that things, they collapse very rapidly, and the opera actually goes very quickly towards the end. But what happens in the third act, in that moment, is that we have that music that deals with her condition when she is sick. Now, the fact that Verdi has put this, at least what I feel about it, maybe another contact will say different things, but this is what I really feel profoundly about that. The fact that Verdi puts this preludio at the beginning that has exactly somehow the same musical material of that says to me that is a musical flashback, as I called it, because it says about it's the presence of death since the very beginning, the sickness of death. In fact, the prelude is a short one, it's like 3 minutes of music, and then just after the last note of the prelude, there is this all of a sudden it's like a curtain that opens in the story. It's a gesture, it's a theatrical gesture about what happens. But so the meaning of that prelude to me is a musical flashback, because it tells us that since the very beginning, when Alfredo and Violetta, they meet, the presence of the death is already there.
We thank you so very much, Maestro Guidarini, for sharing with us this beautiful talk. I think we have a couple of minutes. If you have questions for the maestro, if you have curiosity about the production, or...
How was it received, the Traviata, the first time there?
Well, as I said briefly, I mean, at the beginning it was a shock. It was a shock because of that, because not only because of the theme of this lady living this kind of life, but because of the subject being contemporary, I think. So at the beginning it was really, but the opera being such a masterpiece very rapidly became like obvious. But there was the first performance in Fenice, of course, Fenice, and then in a couple of years was performed all over the planet. So just a shocking good thing.
And we thank once again.